Hello, my name is H.B. Charles, pastor and teacher of the Shiloh Church in Jacksonville, Florida. And I want you to consider this as my personal invitation to you to join us for the 2015 Cutting It Straight Expository Preaching Conference. The goal of this meeting is to teach, model, and encourage faithful Bible exposition for pastors, associate ministers, and Sunday school workers. As well, this year's conference will have a special track that involves specifically a focus on youth ministers and those who lead in the areas of worship and arts. It's going to be a great time of instruction, of fellowship, and of worship. You'll leave encouraged. We hope you'll join us September 2015 for Cutting It Straight. Thank you for watching the broadcast of the Shiloh Church, Jacksonville and Orange Park. We're delighted that you would join us for today's episode. We're going to get right to the message, and I hope you'll be blessed by what you hear.
This is Jesus' invitation to the exhausted. Jesus' invitation to the exhausted. August 1930, Joseph Crater waved goodbye to friends after sharing a meal with them in a New York City restaurant. He flagged down a cab, got in, rolled off, and has not been seen or heard from since then. Because Crater was a successful New York Supreme Court justice, the investigation was quickly launched and speedily expanded. Kidnapping, mafia involvement, even suicide were all considered options, but over 80 years of investigation has only produced countless theories and no conclusions about what had happened to Joseph Crater. The best clue in almost a century of investigation was found in Crater's apartment. On the table, there was a note attached to the check, both addressed to his wife. The check was for a sizable amount, and the note simply read, "I am very weary, love, Joe." They could have easily dismissed that as the passing statement of a fatigued man after a long day, but that clue caught their attention in that it might be the testimony, the epitaph of a despairing man. Hear it again. I am very weary. Are you weary today? I'm not talking about physical or mental weariness. I am talking about a deeper, greater weariness described in the words of Augustine, who prayed, "You have made us, O Lord, for yourself, and our souls are restless until we find rest in you." There is a restlessness of the soul that cannot be fulfilled by anything or anyone but God. But how can I find rest in God? There are two options. Options number one is that you can try to work to God for yourself. But this is no real option, is it? It only increases and intensifies the weariness. The only real option is to accept Jesus' invitation to the exhausted. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Eugene Peters' Message paraphrase puts it this way: are you weary? Are you worn out? Are you burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and recover your life. Let me show you where true rest is found. Walk with me, work with me, watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I will not put anything too heavy or ill-fitting on you. Follow me and I will show you how to live lightly and freely. This is Jesus's invitation to the exhausted at the end of Matthew chapter 11. At the beginning of this chapter, we find an important turning point in the ministry of Jesus as the people of Israel here in earnest began to reject the messianic claims of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the face of growing hostility, Jesus responds in verses 25 and 26 in prayer. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. While people are turning their back on Jesus, he pauses in prayer and thanks God the Father for the sovereign mystery of salvation, in that those who you thought would get it missed it, and those you thought would never got it received it. How did that happen? Verse 27, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Here is a clear statement of the sovereign grace of God in salvation. You cannot know God the Father or God the Son unless God the Father, God the Son, choose to reveal themselves to you. Let me try it another way. You don't choose God, God chooses you. But alongside this statement of divine sovereignty is our text, where Jesus extends an open invitation. An open invitation that teaches us how to find the rest in God that is only to be had through faith in Jesus Christ. How does one find the true rest God gives? First, you must accept the invitation Jesus extends. Accept the invitation Jesus extends. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 is a great declaration of Jesus, a golden verse of the New Testament, and arguably one of the best invitations of all time. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Do you see how the verse neatly divides into three parts: the call, the condition, and the consequence? Note first the call. Come to me. The Christian life can be summarized, friends, in three words: come, follow, go. The command to go is the call to Christian mission. Matthew 28, verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. The call to follow is the call to Christian discipleship. Matthew 4, verse 19, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. But the call to come is the call to Christian salvation. Watch this. You got to come to Jesus before you can follow Jesus. Here in this word come, we find a call to personal relationship. Go emphasizes God's concern that your life be productive. Follow emphasizes God's concern for the growth in your life. But the word come tells us God is not just concerned about your purpose and your growth. He's concerned about you. God wants to do something in you
God wants to do something through you, but first, God wants to do something for you. Before he says follow, before he says go, he first says come. Come to me. The invitation is both personal and exclusive. Come to me. That's a personal invitation. I don't think you got it. Let me try it this way. Jesus says, come to me, not go to church. I don't know a better place than the church than to find Jesus, where the songs of praise to Jesus are sung, where the scriptures about Jesus are read, where the people who love Jesus are gathered, where the truth of Jesus is proclaimed. No better place than the church to find Jesus. But going to church and coming to Jesus are not the same thing. If you're not careful, your hard heart can use church to hide out from Jesus. You need more than church attendance. You need a personal relationship. This is what Jesus offers when he says, come to me. It is an exclusive invitation. That is, the call to rest is extended from every quarter, but no true rest can be found except in Jesus. You cannot find rest in people, only Jesus. You cannot find rest in things, only Jesus. There is no rest in material possessions, economic status, business success. There is no rest to be found in drugs and alcohol. It's like cotton candy. It tastes good, has no substance. No rest to be found, watch this, in church attendance, religious ritual, denominational affiliation, ecstatic experience, or high-profile preachers. No church, no creed, no clergyman can give you rest. Only Jesus. In John chapter 5, verses 39 and 40, Jesus says to a group of unbelievers, you search the scriptures because you think that it is in them that you will find life, but they testify about me, and you won't come to me that you might have life. In other words, Jesus says, you can study the scriptures and still get no rest, because you will not find life in the scriptures until you meet the life giver in the scriptures. Jesus says, I am the way. John 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no going. Without the life, there is no growing. Rest can only be found in Jesus. And so he says, come to me. And after the call, there is the condition. All who labor and are heavy laden. In that phrase, we see this invitation of Jesus is both open and restricted at the same time. Open and restricted at the same time. First, the invitation is open. You can note this word, all. Who can come? All. Rich or poor? All. White or black? All. Young or old? All. Male or female? All. High class, middle class, no class. It doesn't matter. All can come. Accept the invitation Jesus extends. Secondly, obey the discipline Jesus commands. Verse 28 is a call to salvation, but verses 29 and 30 are a call to submission. In verse 28, Jesus says, if you come to me, I'll deliver you from the yoke
of sin and lift from your shoulders the heavy load of guilt. But then in verse 29, he says, when I do that, there's something else you need to do. Take my yoke on you. Learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. To experience true rest, Jesus says, you must not only accept my invitation, you must obey my commands. Two commands, verse 29. Two commands in verse 29. Here's the first. Jesus commands you to put on his yoke. A yoke. Do you know what a yoke is? I grew up in the city. I had to look it up. It's a wooden harness that would be placed over the neck of oxen or mule or beast of burdens to tie them to the plow and to one another. And metaphorically, the term is used to speak of mandatory obligation. It is subjection to another. Scripture uses the term to talk about being yoked to the law, yoked to religious demands, subjected to the religious system. This was the problem of Israel in Jesus' day. They were yoked to one rule after one ritual, after one requirement, one after another. And they were burdened down trying to obey more than 600 commands. The Pharisees said you had to obey to be right with God. But the word yoke was also used to speak of the oppression of enemies. When they were under subjection to foreign authorities, it was said they were under the yoke of the oppressor. Both realities was true of Israel at the time of Jesus. They were under the yoke of the religious system of the Jews and under the yoke of the political authority and oppression of the Romans. Jesus used this terminology they would no doubt be familiar with and says, the way to deal with that yoke is to put on my yoke. What do we got here? Do you got a bait and switch here? Is Jesus playing games with us? In verse 28, he says, I'll take off the yoke and give you rest. Now in verse 29, he says, then put on my yoke. Huh? This is a paradox. G.K. Chesterton said, a paradox is a truth standing on its head trying to get attention. When Jesus says, put on my yoke, he is teaching us about the nature of rest. He is trying to tell us that rest is not freedom from any and all responsibility. Rest is to be bound to the purpose for which you were created. This is not lawlessness. This is not antinomianism. This is not hypergrace. This is not you can get saved and do your own thing. Jesus is saying here that the only way to truly experience grace is to bind your life to the purpose of God for which you were created. I don't know if you got it. Let me try. Is a kite free when it disconnects from the string it is yoked to? Or is it only truly free when it is yoked to the one who holds the strings? No, look, that's all. I got another one. Is a bird free when it gets out of the yoke of the feathers and the wings? Or is it only truly free to soar when it is yoked to the weight of the wings that enables it to fly? Y'all making me work harder than I should. Got one more though. Is a train free when it jumps the track and goes its own way? Or is it only truly free when it is bound to the track and led to a specific destination?
Jesus is saying, friend, you will never find true rest when you are trying to live your own way. Freedom only comes through submission to Jesus. Adrian Rogers said it this way. He calls it the law of kingdom authority. It is simply this. In order to get over what God has put under you, you got to learn how to get under what God has put over you. True submission is the way to rest. So Jesus says, put on my yoke. Sunday school finished, and the teacher reviewed the lesson and said, so as we learn today, what is the yoke of Jesus? Little girl said, it's when Jesus puts his arms around your neck to love you and tell you how much he cares about you. That's the yoke. It is not something too burdensome. It is the loving way of Jesus to keep you away from what will harm you and lead you to what will bless you. And so he says, take my yoke, learn from me. To put on the yoke of Jesus is to commit to learn of him. To learn from him. You got to learn of him, meaning he's the curriculum. But he's also the professor. Learn of him and learn from him. You got to accept the invitation Jesus extends. You have to obey the discipline Jesus commands. But to find rest, you must embrace the benefits Jesus offers. The word rest is used twice in the text. Verse 28, verse 29. Verse 28, it's a gift. Verse 29, it's a reward. Verse 28, Jesus says, I give you rest. Verse 29 says, you will find rest. Do you know you can get to verse 28 and not experience verse 29? You can receive the gift, but never find the discovery of rest. You can receive the gift but never open up the package to enjoy the rest. How does that happen? It happens because there are too many times we want to trust Jesus as Savior but reject him as Lord. Give me verse 28. I'll take the rest, you keep the yoke. Just give me rest, but don't try to tell me how to live. Y'all don't look so convicted. There are three purpose clauses, explanatory clauses in the text that gives three reasons why you ought to trust the commands of Jesus, no matter how burdensome it may seem to be. Three, quickly. The first is in 29, says you can trust the heart of Jesus. Do you know this is the only verse, Matthew 11 and 29, the only verse in all of the Bible where Jesus describes the character condition of his heart. He doesn't say, I am good, pure, just, holy, and righteous, and all of those virtues apply to Jesus. Instead, he says, I am gentle and lowly. Gentleness is meekness. Meekness is not weakness, it's strength under control. It takes more strength to keep your mouth shut than to tell somebody off. Jesus says, I am gentle and I am lowly. I am humble, that word means. The only person who had the right to act high and mighty humbled himself. In Matthew, go right. One chapter, Matthew 12, verse 20, says that Jesus is the fulfillment of Isaiah 42, verse 3. Isaiah 42, verse 3 predicts of the coming Messiah that a bruised reed he will not break and a smoldering wick he will not quench. That's a great assurance. A bruised reed he will not break. A smoldering wick he will not quench. What does that mean? A bruised reed, a reed was a musical instrument like a flute, and if it broke, there was no way to repair it. The only thing to do was just to break it. And when the oil went out of the lamp, the wick would start smoldering, and the only thing to do was blow it out. But the Bible says Jesus will not break the reed and he will not quench the wick, which means he still finds a way to use broken people. He still finds a way to use empty people. Trust the heart of Christ. Trust the yoke of Christ. He says, my yoke is what? Easy. It's a complex Greek term. It's rendered different ways. Scholars don't know how to nail it here. But it seems like the sense of it in context is that Jesus is simply saying, my yoke is well fitting. My yoke will fit you well. They didn't just put any yoke on an ox. They would cut it out from wood and take measurements of the ox and then begin to prepare it. And then in the middle of the process, they would bring the ox to try it on. And then they would design it around the size and strength of the ox so it wouldn't be ill-fitting or scratch or too burdensome. They wanted to make sure the yoke, watch me, was tailor-made for the ox. And this is what Jesus is saying. I know what's best for you, and a yoke your friend carries, I know it doesn't mean you can carry. And I'll make sure whatever yoke I put on you will fit you well. William Barclay speculates that this was the calling card of Jesus when he was in Joseph's carpenter shop in Nazareth. That Jesus did his work so well in the carpenter shop that he had a reputation in the community. He said Jesus, his calling card was, my yokes fit well. And he said Jesus took that from the carpenter shop to the Heavenly Father's kingdom. I'm not sure if that's true, but either way, the reality is he knows what's best for you. He knows what you are able to bear, and his yoke will fit you well.
Shiloh Church is on ABC Channel 25 every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. So fill your widescreen with the good news of the gospel.